growth restriction, and my main aim is I want all of you to listen to the fetus. So fetal growth restriction is a major challenge in antenatal care. And fetal growth, it describes the, with those fetuses that does not grow to its expected biological potential in utero. And why do we need to address this issue? Because fetal growth restriction leads to significant perinatal mortality and morbidity and subsequent long-term deficits. Now, what are the scenario in Bangladesh? According to UNICEF, in Bangladesh, the main cause of neonatal death is prematurity, and which accounts for about 30%. And the complications, the perinatal mortality and morbidity of these FGR infants, they suffer from about for about 3 to 20 times greater due to this perinatal mortality and morbidity comparing to the normal infants. Now, this was a study which was done in Netherlands among a huge population, where they saw that the rate of the perinatal mortality rises with the declination, of the birth weight centiles, and the highest mortality is seen less than 2 percentile. Now, regarding the complication, these FGR fetuses passes through a series of complications throughout their whole life. So we need to identify those persons who are at risk of having FGR fetuses. Like there are maternal risks, there are fetal factors, and there are placental factors as well. So before touching the probe, we need to have a detailed history about the patient, whether the patient has any of these issues or whether the patient has any susceptibility to have this to face this FGR problem. Now, we all know that the growth depends on growth potential, which is derived from both the parents, and also it depends on the substrate supply, which is derived from the placenta, and depends on the uterine and placental vascularity. And if I want to talk to you about the growth restriction, I will divide it into two parts. One is diagnosis, another is management. And to diagnose, we need to define FGR, and to define FGR, we need specific tools to diagnose that. So, for example, growth chart and Doppler. Accurate dating, estimate the fetal weight, and estimation of the fetal weight correctly and the fetal growth velocity plays a crucial role in fetal growth assessment. Now, let's come to dating. And it is the best window. The best window of dating is 11 to 30 weeks, 13 weeks period by measuring the CRL, because it is most precise. Because it is most precise, most accurate, and it has less inter-observer variability. Now, there are certain rules on dating. We can redate the pregnancy only if there is a discrepancy between the GA by LMP and the GA by ultrasound is more than 7 days in first trimester. We can also change the date. Now, if the antiscranial scan is unavailable or missed, then we can date by the early pregnancy scan. And late booking, if it is a case of late booking or unknown LMP or discrepant dates or something like that, then we can go ahead and take the head circumference for the dating. Now, once the EDD has been assigned to a baby, then do not change it in every scan, because new date every time will fool us. Now, from 14 weeks and onwards, biparietal diameter, head circumference, abdominal circumference, and femoral length should be measured. And these measurements should be taken according to a standard and ideal methodology. And ESO guideline is preferred amongst those. And there are separate charts, growth charts for these individual measurements. And from these biometric measurements, estimated fetal weight is then calculated by using different formulae. And here we need to know what is meant by fetal size and fetal growth. Fetal size is the consequence of preceding fetal growth that reflects the fetal nutrition, whereas fetal velocity, it is something dynamic. It is the rate of the fetal growth that is given over a specific period of time, and the serial measurement at about more than 2 weeks interval are needed to assess the fetal growth. Now, I'm going to show you a very interesting thing. I have plotted. Hello, is there any problem? Are you listening to me? Okay.
Continue. Yes,
we are listening.
Okay, thank you. And here I have plotted estimated fetal weight in different type of growth charts, growth charts. And here you can see that the fetus is was about the gestational age according to the LNP was about 34 weeks 3 days, and the expected fetal weight was 1917 grams, and the GA was 31 weeks 6 days. So we are not going to look at this 31 weeks 6 days. We have to look at the fetal weight over here. And I have plotted it in different available charts now. In the population-based chart and the integral chart, what do you see? Here we can see the fetal growth is above the fifth percentile. Here it's above the fifth percentile. But what do we see in the Havelock and the Ho chart? Both of these charts shows that the fetal weight is below the fifth percentile. Now we are in real problem, which chart to choose and which way to go. Now, here comes the actual need for appropriate choice of the charts. And we should always look for those charts where the fetal weight is comprised, the fetal weight or the data is comprised of the estimated fetal weight in normal healthy pregnancies, and which reflects how the babies should go in real circumstances. Now, we have Havelock, Intergrowth, and Ho charts amongst them. And we always know, and it is information for everyone, that Havelock is still now the most reliable formula. Now let's talk about the growth interval. What do you mean by growth interval? How much of a fall of a growth is significant and over what period of time? Crossing more than two quartiles, that means the fall by 50 percentile is included in the recent definition of fetal growth restriction according to the Delphi consensus. And it is, as you can easily assume, that this growth interval is only applicable for those who are above the 10 percentile. Fetal weight is above the 10 percentile. And if you see a drop from 80th percentile to the 30th percentile, then everybody knows that this fetus is really facing some problem and this fetus needs attention. Now let's come to the Doppler assessment, because we know that the Doppler is an earliest indicator of fetal compromise. And Doppler gives us both diagnostic and prognostic guideline in management of fetal growth restriction. Now, this is a quick recapitulation of what we already know. The uterus is supplied by the uterine artery, and the placenta has two compartments. One is the maternal part and one is the fetal part. And the fetal receives all the oxygenated blood through the umbilical vein, which passes through the ductus venosus and is shooted to the left atrium without getting mixed with the right atrium. And from the left atrium, it passes into the arch of the aorta and supplies the fetal brain and upper part of the body. And now what happens? From the deoxygenated blood from the rest of the body accumulates in the right atrium. And from there, it goes to the pulmonary trunk, and through the ductus arteriosus, it gets mixed with the aorta, and here the blood becomes mixed. Mixedly oxygenated, it's not totally deoxygenated. And from the umbilical arteries, through the umbilical arteries, this mixed blood is then passed over to the through the placenta to the mother again. Now, amongst these vessels, uterine artery and the umbilical artery are taken as placental markers. Middle cerebral artery and aortic isthmus are counted as fetal arterial markers, and ductus venosus and umbilical vein, these are fetal venous markers. Now let's come to the Doppler indices. Which amongst these Doppler indices, which one should I take for our assessment for fetal growth restriction? PI should be taken, because PI shows the linear correlation with the vascular resistance. Now let's come to uterine artery. We all know that the uterine during pregnancy, the uterine artery gets invaded by the trophoblastic cells and it gets dilated, and there is a reduced low resistance flow pattern, which helps the nutrition and the oxygenation of the placenta and the baby as well. So this is the typical flow. This is the typical flow that we usually see in the first trimester, and this is the flow we can see in the early second trimester. But from the late part of the second trimester and throughout the third trimester, there should be a low resistant flow like this. Now, let's come to the clinical approach of uterine artery, because it is counted as a screening tool, not a role. It has no role in surveillance. and mean PI percentile is according to the gestational age is single most criteria to count, and it indicates poor perinatal outcome, indicates twofold increase in risk of abnormal brain doctor at term, and it also increases the chances of maternal preeclampsia. Now let's come to our very favorite umbilical artery. Umbilical artery represents the fetal part of the placenta, and it represents the placental resistance. Normally, it has a biphasic flow with decreased resistance in the diastole, decreased resistance and forward flow in the diastole. Now, here, this slide is very important because we know that the umbilical artery will change only if there is at least 30% damage to the tertiary villus. So, whenever there is 30% damage to the tertiary villus, we will find a high resistant flow pattern. And if it is 60% villus loss, then we will find there will be absent end-diastolic flow. And it will get reversed if it is a case of 30% of the villus loss. Now let's concentrate into three important features. One is if the placenta is damaged and it is more than 30%, then the umbilical artery will be abnormal and the fetal will know, and fetal will restrict its growth from a very early stage, and it will turn out to be a case of early onset FGR. And if the placenta is less than 30%, then the fetal umbilical artery will be normal, but the fetal will restrict its growth whenever its demands gets higher. That means it will be a case of late onset FGR. Now, if the involvement or the damage is something more than 30%, near about say about 15% or 20%, anything like that, then the fetal growth restriction, there will be in these cases we might find that the estimated fetal weight may be above 10th percentile, but these fetuses may be hypoxic at term. Now let's know about the clinical application. Umbilical artery acts as both diagnostic and prognostic tool for surveillance of FGR. PI more than 95th percentile and reduced absence or reverse diastolic flow warrants proper surveillance. Absent diastolic flow represents hypoxemia, and reversed end-diastolic flow represents suspicious for acidosis. These changes appear about 1 week before acute deterioration, and it always precedes a CTG change. Now let's come to the middle cerebral artery. Middle cerebral artery, we all know that it represents the cerebral supply. Normally, the MCA shows a high impedance flow pattern like this with a forward flow in the diastole. And in case of pathological, whenever there will be pathology, it will show a high resistance flow pattern like this. And let's know about its clinical application. It is a surrogate marker for hypoxia, and less than 5th percentile predicts hypoxia. An abnormal MCAPI indicates adverse perinatal and neurological outcome. Late FGRs with abnormal MCAPI have poorer neurobehavioral competence after birth. Now, this is a very important thing to know about the cerebral placental ratio. We can calculate it by dividing the MCPI by the umbilical artery PI. Thus, the CPR alters when its individual components are altered, but still within the normal limits. That means this CPR is even more sensitive than its individual components. This CPR is essentially a diagnostic index, more especially in case of hypoxia. An abnormal CPR predicts neurological problems after birth. Now let's come to the dynamic vessel, which is duodenum. It is the strongest and single Doppler parameter to predict the risk of fetal death in early onset FGRs. If the ductus venosus PI is more than 95th percentile, it is associated with higher risk. Absent and reversed A wave, that is during an atrial contraction, are associated with perinatal mortality. And whenever we find a reversed A wave, it is sufficient to recommend urgent delivery at any gestational age after completion of steroids. And in 90% of the cases, if it is abnormal, 48 to 70, it gets abnormal 48 to 72 hours before the changes of the biophysical profile. And this is the normal flow of the ductus venosus. We have already seen this type of flow in Dr. Zerinappa's presentation. And this is the reversed AV. Now let's come to the aortic isthmus. Aortic isthmus is a small portion of the aorta that lies in between the left subclavian artery and the ductus arteriosus. So normally it has a triphasic flow pattern. It has a small dip in the diastole just at its at the early diastolic period. But if there is a problem or hypoxia, there will be reverse flow in the diastole. Now, what is its clinical importance? This vessel reflects the balance between the impedance of the cerebral part and the rest of the systemic circulation. And reversed aortic isthmus flow is a sign of severe placental insufficiency and could justify elective delivery beyond 34 weeks of gestation. And it precedes the ductus venosus abnormality by 1 week. So first, we will get aortic isthmus abnormality, and then we'll get the ductus venosus abnormality. And aortic isthmus Doppler, this is associated with increased fetal mortality and neurological consequences early in the childhood. Now that we have the Doppler findings and the biometric findings in our hand, how to go forward? We now need to define what is the segregation. What are the types of the growth in the fetus? Now, AGA fetus, that means the appropriate for growth fetuses, are the one whose size is within the normal range. Either its individual parameters or the total calculated weight should be within 10th to 90th percentiles. And what do you mean by SGA? SGA, this term is used to differentiate another subgroup. I repeat, a subgroup of small fetuses with normal Doppler studies. There seems to be no features of fetal adaptation because these fetuses are otherwise normal. So they are termed as constitutionally normal fetus. Now let's come to FGR, that is the main focus of today. FGR is normally used to refer those small fetuses which are at higher risk in uterine deterioration, stillbirth, and overall poorer perinatal outcome. And these fetuses are thought to have true growth restrictions. Now, these fetuses are always associated with Doppler signs of hemodynamic distribution and this placental disease and higher risk of preeclampsia. Now, we can now have a clear idea, I think, because the small fetus, the broad headline, it is a broad umbrella and three groups of small babies goes under them. One is constitutionally normal one, other having uteroplacental dysfunction, another group having they are small due to because of their chromosomal, hormonal, and structural infections. Now we have already described Asia babies are, that means they are the, having the birth weight within the third and the 10th percentile with normal Doppler studies. And what are the FGRs? These are less than, either the weight is less than third percentile or 10th percentile with abnormal Doppler changes. Now, how do I differentiate SGA from FGRs? SGAs, there will be no Doppler signs. It is mostly, these are the constitutionally small babies, and there are normal perinatal outcome, and there are less chances, almost no chances of intrauterine fetal death, and they can taken, they can be, this pregnancy can be prolonged up to term. But what happens with FGR, placental insufficiency will be there, and there will be Doppler signs of adaptation, and there will also be poor perinatal outcome and intrauterine fetal death, and these pregnancies cannot be prolonged beyond 37 weeks. And that is very important, and we need to understand when we need to address these fetuses and take good care of them. Now, how do I identify this FGR fetuses truly? According to a large RCT trial done by Figueres and Gratacos, and according to their publication, they included CPR, uterine artery Doppler, and the estimated fetal weight less than third percentile to. And after that, they saw that a remarkable portion of SGA can be grouped under this FGA group. So now the extended definition according to that study is now the we can define FGR when there is estimated fetal weight below 10 percentile with any of CPR, less than 5th percentile, uterine artery PI, more than 95th percentile, or estimated fetal weight less than 5th percentile. Now let's come to a newer concept, which is early and late onset FGR. Now, what is early onset and what is late onset? Whenever it will be evident before 32 weeks, it's early, and after 32 weeks, it's late. And it's not just a cutoff like that, or just like cutting a cake like that. No, it's not that. It's an arbitrary cutoff. 32 to 34 weeks is considered as this demarcating gestational age. Now, what do we find in? How do I define this early onset FGR? Here, will AC or estimated fetal weight will be along the below the third percentile, or umbilical artery in the absent in the steric flow will be seen in the umbilical artery, or AC or EFW is less than 10 percentile combined with uterine artery abnormality more than 95th percentile and or umbilical artery PI more than 95th percentile. So it appears to be a bit complicated, but while you will start working with all these things, it will become, I'm pretty sure that these things will become very easier for you to pick up. Now, let's see what happens and how do I define this late FGRs. Late FGRs are seen, and I've already told that it's seen in more than 32 weeks, and AC and estimated fetal weights should be less than third percentile or any two of the three of the following. One is AC or estimated fetal weight less than 10 percentile associated with AC or estimated fetal weight crossing more than two quartiles on the both centiles, or CPR less than fifth centile, or umbilical artery PI more than 95th percentile. Those are all numbers, and that seems to be quite complicated at this moment for some of you. Now let's see what happens in early FGR and late FGR. In case of early FGR, there is severe placental disease, and umbilical artery Doppler will be abnormal, and these cases are usually high association with preeclampsia, and these babies will be hypoxic, and there will be systemic cardiovascular adaptations, and these babies will be immature because they will start growing small earlier. They will be immature fetus, and there will be high tolerance to hypoxia. Over here, the mortality and morbidity rate is higher, but it has a low prevalence. Over all the FGR, they account for about 20 to 30%. Now, here the problem is the management. But in case of late FGR, there will be mild placental disease, umbilical artery will be normal, and they have not that much association with preeclampsia. The babies are hypoxic, but there will be central cardiovascular adaptation, and these fetuses will be mature, but with a lower tolerance of hypoxia. This is very important. They have a lower tolerance for hypoxia, and they have a common chance of stillbirth. But here the problem is diagnosis, because these cases present at term. Now we can easily assume that the early onset placental dysfunction, it affects the nutrition or growth rather than respiratory compromise. But over here it affects the respiratory demand rather than the nutritional demand. Now let's see what are the pathological cascades that happens in early FGR. Early FGR, there is placental disease in a severe form, and there will be increment, that means the increase in the placental impedance, uterine artery will be abnormal, and ultimately the umbilical artery will get abnormal, and as a result, the CPR will be altered. In compensated state of hypoxia, there will be decentralization or redistribution or centralization of the fecal flow, and there will be increased flow in the cerebral arteries, and the PI will get less. And ultimately, when the hypoxic level is goes down to its bottom level, the aortic isthmus will show abnormality at the decompensated hypoxic state. And ultimately, there will be cardiac ischemia, diastolic failure. And after that, we'll see that the ductus venosus will be altered. And at this time, whenever we see the aortic isthmus change, it will take 7 to 10 days to reach the grave situation if not picked up earlier and properly. And gradually there will be CTG changes and everything, and there will be loss of cardiac failure. Now, Now let's come to the late FGR. Late FGR, the placental disease is milder. We have already known that it's less than 30%, and there will be increased placental resistance over there, and there will be centralization due to that. Umbilical artery will be normal all through, but due to this centralization, this will stay like that till the hypoxia is compensated. Whenever it becomes decompensated, there will be changes in the aortic isthmus. But this is a main important point. Whenever you see an abnormal aortic isthmus change, you know that you have even only hours for that grave ending. So it's very important to see aortic isthmus in case of this FGR. So after this, the CTG changes will be there, and these fetuses, they are mildly hypoxic, but as they don't have any cardiovascular adaptations prior to this whole process, they are minimally tolerant to hypoxia. That is the only reason they cannot be saved, and we have a very only few hours in our hand to save this baby. Now, what about the cardiovascular adaptation in case of early FGR? The fetal heart has to work more, but it eventually fails, and the doctor's diagnosis becomes normal. But in case of late onset, the heart is all right. But what happens to the brain? The brain or the brain stem, the respiratory centers and other centers, they become down first. While in case of the early FGR, the heart will go down first. Now, having all this in mind, let's go to the stage-based protocol of managing fetal growth restriction. And I will emphasize on Barcelona protocol because it is one of the single, it is a very important protocol which is accepted and practiced in most of the countries in the world. Now, according to their protocol, they have divided these FGR fetuses according to their severity into four different stages. And if we see there is CPR less than 5th percentile, uterine artery more than 95th percentile, MCA less than 50th percentile, then we can just recognize that the fetus is having mild placental resistance and there is redistribution. So they can be grouped under stage one. And if we see absent endosomal flow in the umbilical artery or aortic isthmus more than 95th percentile or reversal, we know that there is severe placental resistance or redistribution. These fetuses are stage as two. And if we see the ductus venosus PI is raised and there is endosomal flow in the umbilical artery, then it we can easily assume that this is a case of severe hemodynamic adaptation and there is low suspicion of acidosis. So stage one and stage two deals with hypoxia, but stage three and stage four deals with acidosis. What happens in stage four? Stage four, there we will find the reversal of the A wave and there will be CTG deceleration as well. So, now how do we take decisions regarding the delivery of these critical patients? Now, our current practice is a critical balance between the risk of continuing intrauterine pregnancy, intrauterine existence, and the risk of prematurity, because you can't deliver a child unnecessarily with the high risk of prematurity, or you cannot leave the pregnancy in utero having the risk of IUFD. Now, Doppler helps us this decision making very critically or crucially because it balances, it lets us know about the hypoxic state and acidemic state and everything, so we can balance between the prematurity and hypoxia in our decision making. Now, this is a very important slide where chances, where I am showing that the chances of survival without being handicapped increases by 2% per day before 28 weeks and increases by 1% by day after 32 weeks. No, now this is the whole thing that I was talking about all through. And here I have this is the Barcelona protocol, including the monitoring and the suggested mode of delivery. And it seems to be a bit complicated at this moment, but let me bring it a bit simpler, in a bit simpler form to you. And I'm grateful to Dr. Bimal Sahani because he has given this lecture and typically described IUGR in our last two international conferences that was arranged by BSRI. So if the fetal weight is more than 37 weeks, then FGR at any stage, then we should always recommend to deliver. Now, if the fetus is less than 30, more than 34 weeks, and if the fetus is under stage 1, quickly monitoring, stage 2, 3, 4, recommend for delivery. Now, if the fetus is 30 to 34 weeks, then stage 1, weekly monitoring, stage 2, twice weekly monitoring, stage 3 and 4, we should always recommend to deliver. And what will happen to 26 to 30 weeks of age? If stage 1, weekly, stage 2, twice weekly, stage 3, daily monitoring, and stage 4, deliver. Now, this is a very important thing that we should all keep in our mind. That is, if it is a case of early gestational ages or whatever the fetal age may be or whatever the stage may be, if there is coexistence with severe preeclampsia, then this fetus may deteriorate at any moment unexpectedly. So strict fetal monitoring is warranted in these cases. Now, this is the total algorithm of the management of FGRs. Now they have started, this is also Barcelona protocol, and you see there are stage-based management and everything, and you can keep it in your office or just underneath your screen or in your ultrasound room. But the most exciting part is you can have it in your smartphone too, by downloading this for free. And if you'll have to go to www.medicinafetalbarcelona.org, and you'll type this and you'll search for this, and this will come to your screen, and you'll just feed in the data over here, put the gestational age, put the estimated fetal weight that you have calculated, you have to put on the Doppler findings over here, and this app will tell you the status or the stage of the fetus. And not only that, it will also guide you what to do and how to take action in this case. Now, let's go through two cases very swiftly. Case one, she came to us with, she was 20 years old, primipara, and at 30 weeks she came to us. Her previous scans were done at 8 weeks for dating, NT scan, and the anomaly scan all revealed normal, and her Doppler findings were also normal. At 30 weeks, the ACE was at 10 percentile. She was estimated fetal weight was 14 percentile, but the CPR was at borderline 5th percentile. So we do have two borderline findings over here. One is the AC and another is the CPR. So, but still the baby is doing fine. So we advise the mother to come after 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, at 32 weeks, we found that the AC was at 8th percentile, CPR was 5th percentile, but the estimated fetal weight went down to 10%. But still, the baby is remaining within the normal range. So we did advise her to come after 2 weeks. Now, at 34 weeks, we found that the estimated fetal weight came down to 4 weeks, which is a criteria to define as FGR, and there was umbilical artery changes, and there was CPR changes, and ductus venosus was normal. So we staged it as a case of stage 1 FGR. And if you can recall, stage 1 FGR, we should follow up weekly, and according to that, we advise the patient to come after 1 week. And after 1 week, that is on 30, at 35 weeks, there was the AC was gone down. The AC was at second percentile, umbilical artery was at 98 percentile, CPR was at first percentile, but ductus venosus was still normal. So it was still continuing its stage 1 status. Now, what happened in stage in stage at 36 weeks, we found all the percentiles were going down, but the ductus venosus was still normal. Still normal. Estimated fetal weight was at first 1 percentile, and so we all know that we give importance to this number 37 weeks, because before, prior to that, we consider the babies to born with the primary risks of prematurity. So we finally decided to wait up to 37 weeks. So first, at 37 weeks, the ductus venosus was still normal, although there were abnormalities over there. So since the baby has crossed 37 weeks, we suggested for delivery, and the baby is doing fine now. So what did we learn from this whole scenario, this case? Iatrogenic prematurity can be avoided or minimized by an evidence-based algorithmic approach and clinical surveys. Now let's go to my case. So case 2 reported at 19 weeks 5 days and her all the parameters
were eta kada deshisto kore nai.
Sorry for the interruption. Please mute yourself. Participant, please mute yourself.
Okay, all the parameters were below third percentile and the fetal weight was at the third percentile. So this was already FGR. Now early onset FGR, definitely we can see that, you can see easily the graphs over here, the uterine artery, where there was high resistive flow pattern, and the umbilical artery shows low high resistive flow pattern, but the MCA shows low resistive, so there was a kind of change of this CPR changes. So with this fetal weight and this Doppler changes, it was stage 1. Now we advise the patient to come after 1 week, but the patient reported us at 26 weeks 5 days, that means after 7 weeks. After 7 weeks, what did we find? We find that the fetal weight was at second percentile, and this is the chart of abdominal circumference and this is the chart of fetal weight, and all of you can understand what's happening there. Now what did we see in the doppler? There was reverse flow in the umbilical artery, so but the ductus venosus was normal. But since we have found the reverse flow in umbilical artery, we staged it down to stage 3 and we decided to follow up this case daily. Now this is the finding I described, and now the patient came on at 27 weeks 3 days. At 27 weeks 3 days, the findings were same, but aortic isthmus reversal was there, ductus venosus showed raised PI more than 95th percentile. But since there was no reverse flow in the A wave in the ductus venosus, this baby can be is still maintaining its stage 3 status. Now after 1 day, she was supposed to come after 1 day, but she came after 2 days. After 2 days, you can easily see there is reversal of A wave, and so it was diagnosed, she was diagnosed as a baby was diagnosed as a case of stage 4, and we advised for urgent delivery, and the baby is now doing fine. Now what did we learn? We learned that the early onset FGR critical and end point should be the reversal of A wave of the ductus venosus. Now in a nutshell, if I want to concise all the points I've discussed all for the last 30 minutes, these are: we should identify a small fetus, we should go for Doppler, distinguish between the FGR and constitutionally small SGAs, and we should stage the FGR and plan the surveillance accordingly, and we should take the decision when to deliver, where to deliver, and how to deliver. And early onset FGRs and late onset FGRs are two distinct phenotypes. I repeat, because these should be recognized as such, because they have totally different pathogenesis and outcome. Now, in early onset FGR, the problem is with perfusion. So the magic point is ductus venosus evaluation is the cornerstone of in case of early onset. And what in case of late onset, the problem is with diffusion, and cerebral placental ratio, CPR, is the critical index. Now to sum up, we have to know our diagnostic and prognostic markers, and we should listen to the fetus, and we should listen to the heart in case of early FGR, and we should listen to the brain in case of late FGR. Thank you for your patient listening, and these are all the website from which I have collected my information so far, and thank you all for your cooperation. Thank you so much.